Hi friends, you are welcome in this video. Friends, in this video we are going to discuss about a poem, an elegy, that is Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard, composed by Thomas Gray. Thomas Gray is a highly self-critical poet in English literature. He has been given the position of poet laureate in 1757, but he rejected or declined it. He did not want to become the poet laureate. So this poet has composed a very fine poem called Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard. And friends, let me tell you that this elegy is often quoted poem in English literature, and this is a very beautiful poem. This is a masterpiece of Thomas Gray, and today we remember Thomas Gray only because of this poem, and here we are dissecting this poem. So friends, first let's understand its structure. Actually, this poem comprises of 128 lines, and these lines we can form into some stanzas. There are 32 stanzas in this poem, and these stanzas are in the form of heroic quatrain. A quatrain is a stanza of 4 lines, and there we find 32 stanzas in this poem. So friends, here again we have alternate rhyming scheme, alternate rhyming pattern used by Thomas Gray in composition, which is a very lucid and a very straightforward rhyming scheme, which creates a kind of rhythm, a music in this poem. So friends, we will go through these stanzas and understand the very summary and the basic theme of this poem, Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard. This elegy has been composed in 1751. Actually, Thomas Gray has started writing this elegy before many years, but this has been published in 1751. So friend, this is his masterpiece and one of the famous elegies in English literature. So we can say that this is most famous elegy as for that matter. So friend, let's start stanza wise. We will go through the stanzas and I will explain you each stanza in this video. There may be possibility of two videos, because this is a long poem which has 32 stanzas. So we will go through these stanzas. So friends, here is the first stanza. We will take first two stanzas and then I will explain. The curfew tolls the knell of parting day, the lowering herd, wind slowly over the lee, the ploughman homeward plods his weary way, and leaves the world to darkness and to me. Now fades the glimmering landscape on the sight, and all the year a solemn stillness holds, save where the beetle wields his droning flight, and drowsy tinkling lull the distant folds. So friend, this is the beginning of the poem. Here poet initiates the very atmosphere, and in this very first stanza and first line we find the tone or mood is somber. He started this poem with a melancholic mode. If we analyze or if we consider these first two stanzas, in this stanza he talks about the parting of the day. The very evening is falling there, and he sat in a churchyard near the graves, and just he is looking outside from that churchyard or from that grave to the way, to the path, and on that path the evening is falling, and we find a ploughman, as he is described, a farmer who is coming from his field to the home, and he also hearing the bells in the necks of cattle. So cattle also going there towards their abode or towards their resting place. A ploughman or a farmer also there is on the road, and here he used particular word, that is knell. So knell is a kind of bell which is useful when there is something mournful incident in the village, or when there is someone dead in the village. Knell. So he uses the very word knell, which is the reminder of the very theme of this poem, that is death. Friends, he has set the mood or tone of poem in these first two stanzas. Let's move to the next stanzas. Here we have third and fourth stanza. Save that from yonder ivy-mantled tower, the mopping owl does to the moon complain, of such a wandering near her secret bower, molest her ancient solitary reign. Beneath those rugged elms that use trees shade, where He used the turf in many a mouldering heap, each in his narrow cell forever laid, the rude forefathers of the hamlet. Now friends, in the third stanza, he has given a description of a owl. There is a owl in the night, and this owl grunts. This owl creates a different kind of sounds, and these sounds also sets the tone or mood of this poem, the very melancholic mood, the very sober kind of mood. And this very sounds created by owl, he thinks that owl is complaining to the moon, that moon when it came in the sky, the moon is just deriving his solitariness, just breaking the silence which is loved by that owl. And in the next stanza or the fourth stanza, he talks about directly to the graves. He talks about the graves in that churchyard, and he says that the different types of cells and small cells in those graves lies the forefathers of that hamlet, means the people who lived in that hamlet. Now they are taking rest, now they are dead, and they are buried in those graves. Now here we have direct theme, that is graves and death. Friends, so these are the first four stanzas. Now this poem gradually moves us into the very theme and into the very subject matter of this poems through different stanzas or coming stanzas. These stanzas gradually or slowly moves forward. So let's think about the next stanzas. The breezy call of incense breathing morn, the swallow twittering from the straw built shell, the cock's shrill clarion, or the echoing horn, no more shall rouse them from their lowly bed. For them no more the blazing hearth shall burn, or busy housewife ply her evening care. No children run to lisp their sire's return, or climb his knees the envied kiss to share. Now friends, those old men or old persons of that village lies in those tombstones or lies in those graves will not return. So these two stanzas, fifth and sixth stanza, is the description of these people who are lying there in the deathbed or in those graves, will not come to home and will not enjoy their earlier life or the very inspirational life they lived there. No one is able to call them back, or their life now has been stood still. And though there we find, if their wife will call them, they will not return, or they will not enjoy the very earthly life, because now they are in the sleep of death, they are in the hands of death, and they will not return. So these are the two next stanzas. Now friends, we have fully entered into this poem, and here the poet or speaker is describing the very life of those people who are lying there in the graves. And in the next stanza he talks about this. Off did the harvest to their sickle yield, their furrow of the stubborn glaive as broke. How jocund did they drive their team afield, how bowed the woods beneath their sturdy stroke. So friends, in this stanza he is remembering, or just he is memorizing the actions or deeds of those people who are buried there. And they are very poor people, but in their young days they have worked in the field, they have worked in teams. So they spent their life while struggling, they spent their life in hard work, they spent their life with a great struggle, and sometimes they also made some merry, and we find merry making in their life. And again friends, in the last line of this stanza, he talks about the trees bowed before them. It means that trees also showed their respect towards this man. And in the next stanza we find a turn in his thought. What did he say in the next stanza? Let me read out this stanza. Let not ambition mock their useful toil, their homely joys and destiny obscure, nor grandeur hear with a disdainful smile the short and simple annals of the poor. Friends, in this stanza he talks about that we should not neglect their toil, we should not neglect their hard work, and no rich person or wealthy person should mock over their toil, mock over their hard work. So it is the annals of poor, means it is the history of poor, and this history also is significant, as we find the history of wealthy men, the history of powerful men. But these men also did a good kind of job in their life. So why did they now remain neglected? This reason has been provided in the next lines of this poem. So here we find a turn in the thought that he is talking about poor and rich people. Now there is a great valley between poor and rich if we consider this poem, and this is also a major theme in this poem. So friend, let's read the next stanza and understand what is there. 9th and 10th stanza. The boast of heraldry, the pomp of power, and all that beauty, all that wealthy ever gave, awaits alike the inevitable hour. The path of glory lead but to the grave. Nor you, ye proud, impute to these the fault, if memory over their tomb no trophies raise, where through the long drawn azure and fretted vault the pealing anthem swells the note of praise. Now friends, he is describing the tombstones and describing the wealthy people and poor people. We find that the tombs of poor people are in dilapidated condition. So they have very poor kind of graves. There is no tombstone erected for them. There is no any poem sung for them. There is no any epitaph on their tombstones or these stones erected. And there is no any kind of inscription on the very stones they have there on their tombs. So friends, but if you look at the tombstones of wealthy people, we find there are fine inscriptions, there are muses, there are different kinds of words written for them. But the poor are in dilapidated condition, though they are in their graves. And friends, here we have a very famous line or a very famous quotation which is often used in English literature. And this quotation is, the path of glory lead but to the grave. So, though you are rich, though you are powerful, though you have wealth, though you have everything, a very prestigious status in the society, but the last path, the path of glory lead but to the grave. Everybody has to go to the grave. Everyone has to go to the grave, and there is no any relaxation from this rule, the rule of nature, the rule of God. And here he remembers all these things in the very poem, Elegy Written in a Country Churchyard.